While producer Scott P. Plummer and a ragtag skeleton crew were fighting a losing battle with Chitboxer, J.R. Bookwalter and a decent chunk of the crew from Zombie Cop powered on with the next project on the list. 1992's Maximum Impact. A movie that, I think, kind of officially marks the end of Bookwalter and the crew's passion for this six-pack project. That's not to say that they hate this movie, rather, I think by this point in production, they'd had the fun side of it and now it was beginning to set in more as work than enjoyment. It's often cruelly referred to as Minimum Impact, and when I say often, that's kind of a fib because this thing's been seen by next to no one. So really, I suppose what I should say is that two or three stoners who picked this up in the Ohio area in 1992 weren't exactly kind to it. And honestly, while it is light years ahead quality-wise when compared to Chitboxer, it is a little bit underwhelming to say the least. Given that the story is super convoluted in its execution, the plot isn't really all that hard to explain. The film follows Jerry, an insurance salesman with a beautiful house and a beautiful wife who I can confirm is also the owner of a large automobile. Jerry's life is pretty nice, and to boot, he's signed up to attend a conference to help improve his skills as a salesman and to maybe try and see what's shaking in the world of insurance sales. Yippers. Anyway, Jerry's a little bit trepidatious about the trip because he's worried he might bump into some people from his past while he's out there, particularly some co-workers of his who were involved in an undisclosed incident that got him and his co-workers in a lot of hot water and left Jerry on the line for more than his actual involvement entailed. At the same time that this happens, we're also introduced to some shady characters working at Huntsacker Industries, which I assume is an insurance company? But they don't really truly clarify. The boss of the company secretly operates a trafficking and supply business on the DL, and they've got a hell of a request on their hands, as someone's agreed to pay them a large chunk of money if they'll shoot a snuff movie porno for them. The boss sends a hitman out to find people in the area, and it just so happens that the area the boss has sent the scouts out to look for victims is the same area where Jerry's insurance conference is taking place. We then head back over to Jerry, who arrives at the conference and quickly reconnects with Phil, a co-worker who was involved in the incident. And after a brief tussle of words, the pair decide to bury the hatchet, and once the conference is done, the pair head to a local restaurant to get a bite to eat. It's there that one of the Huntsacker scouts, who goes by the name of George, corners the pair and offers them a night of total pleasure with a beautiful woman. No strings attached. The only catch is that they just can't tell anyone they're going for it if they choose to do it. Jerry at first seems tempted, but tells the scout where to go before heading off. Phil, on the other hand, while quieter, agrees eventually, and a short time later the snuff movie's in full swing. The problem is, Jerry passes by the hotel room that the movie has been shot in and sees Phil get murdered. He hangs around, and while one of the henchmen goes to pick up a pizza at the front of the building, Jerry heads into the room and finds out that the girl who was involved in the snuff porn, Tanya, had no idea that the gun she was using was live. She was told it was a prop and that it was all just fetish stuff. And so, shaken, Jerry and Tanya head out to Jerry's car and the pair race back to his house to fill his partner in on what's going on and to plan the next best move. However, the guys over at Huntsucker catch wind that the snuff shoot didn't exactly go to plan. They're pissed off that there was a witness to the murder, and they're seriously pissed off that Tanya's run off because he was the boss's best girl. And so, with limited information and a vague idea of what they're looking for, the scouts head out to track down Jerry and Tanya. And what follows is a third act showdown of moderate proportions. As Jerry, his partner, and Tanya all prepare to potentially get whacked, the goons try to track down Jerry and Tanya, and the boss just gets angrier and angrier about the situation. All of this builds to, well, a happening. I'd say it was a climax, but I gotta be honest, it's quite underwhelming. And that's the movie. I really wish I could be nicer to it, but the reality of the situation is that this is just a pretty passable film. Just. As a thriller, it's a bit messy, but it's not necessarily bad. As an action movie, it's quite underwhelming. And as I said at the top of this review, I just kind of feel like the passion and steam had gone out of the team by this point in terms of wanting to produce something next level. Like I say, it's not bad, but it does rather feel a bit autopilot-y at times. Kicking things off, the script's alright. I think it's severely hobbled by budget and location limitations. Had this movie been shot on film with some decent lighting and a bit more cash to splash, it'd probably play out quite a bit better than it does here. It's an action thriller at its core, and while it does bring the thrills, it's somewhat lacking on the action front. It's supposed to be quite a harrowing watch, maybe something in the vein of Straw Dogs. But because the budget's so low, they've ended up having to reuse locations from other movies they've shot at with a limited range of cast, limited kit resources, and not a great deal of scope to shoot above professionally acceptable. Equally, with this being shot over Christmas, many cast members on the shoot admitted to not really giving the script their all because, well, it's Christmas, and the mixture of frigid temperatures and a cast and crew more worried about the holidays than in getting results leaves what could have potentially been a decent little spinner completely high and dry. Once again, the act structure is kinda mangled. Given that this film is 62 minutes long, you'd expect each act to occupy around about 20 minutes. But I'm having real trouble identifying what the second act of this film is. The first act is pretty simple. It runs from the beginning of the movie up to roughly when George enters the frame to propose a night of passion. But the second act kinda has two starting points. You could either start from the moment the Snuff movie begins production, or the moment that Tanya and Jerry escape. And that second act is ridiculously short compared to the first act, and it kinda plunges you into a third act that tonally feels quite out of place with the rest of the movie. That's another flaw with this one. The pacing's a bit all over the place. Now, I can appreciate that a decent chunk of this film's script probably got deleted for time and that inevitably as a result some things will get lost in translation. But there's a scene in the third act where it's revealed that Jerry has an underground armory. This, as far as I can recall, is never brought up before the underground armory reveal, and up to that point Jerry hasn't been given any indications that he's even remotely someone who likes guns, let alone grenade launchers and AK-47s. There are tons of little moments like this throughout the film. Our initial introduction to Huntsacker is the boss giving one of his henchmen a job which we never see enacted, and that's just never brought up again. Narrative-wise, it's just totally disjointed, and it makes it quite difficult to really review the script as its own thing because it feels like I'm watching a supercut of a longer movie at times. One thing I can say is a plus here is the dialogue is nice and fluid. For the most part, the stilted dialogue is kept to a minimum, and there aren't anywhere near as many references or Easter eggs to other movies in this one. And I really kind of dug that this was just a movie that stood alone. It maybe borrowed some visuals from the action thriller genre, but nothing I could spot immediately made me go, ah, that's a reference to this movie. So that's a definite plus. Originally, this was supposed to be co-written by J.R. Bookwalter and Matthew Jason Walsh, but due to a disagreement, Walsh walked off the project entirely, leading Bookwalter to hire in Thomas Brown to help co-write this. Bookwalter himself would also co-write and direct this feature under the pseudonym Lance Rondaz. In terms of credits, Thomas has only one really, and that's for a 1993 documentary created to celebrate the 25th anniversary of Night of the Living Dead called Reflections of the Living Dead. And here? Well, it's kind of hard to judge what he ended up submitting because large chunks of his original script were deleted or reworked on set. I think what is left here is just about passable. Disjointed? Yes. Badly paced? Yes. But entertaining? Well, I wasn't bored. Underwhelmed maybe, but definitely not bored. Direction-wise, it's equally just passable. It's not bad by any stretch, but there's no real creative flair here. The best we get in that regard are the shots of Huntsacker Industries. You see, for some reason, while the rest of the film uses largely natural light or floodlight-esque set lighting, the Huntsacker stuff uses super low, smoky, moody lighting, which I thought was really nice, and very much added to the sense of menace that those scenes already gave off. The shots of Jerry's underground armory also used coloured light gels, which equally were a nice touch. But outside of that, there just isn't really a lot going on. It feels professionally functional. We're nowhere near as bad as chick boxers plop the camera down, are they in focus, are they in shot, okay go, cut, perfect, type of filmmaking. There's a clear sign of craft in making sure the vision here is consistent and that it at least looks like a professional product. But it's just lacking any kind of JR flair. Like, if you showed me this, Zombie Cop and Robot Ninja, and asked me to pick which film wasn't a J.R. Bookwalter film, I'd pick this movie. And I wouldn't believe you if you told me all three were done by the same guy. It just doesn't have that fine touch, that director's seal that makes you go, oh, this is a this person's movie. It just feels a bit lifeless. Functional, but lifeless. Direction of the cast's pretty good though. In that regard, I think JR's come a long way over these early movies. When I think back to how mediocre the acting was in Kingdom of the Vampires, here it's good and solid. Cast members regularly move around the shot, no one really feels or looks lost, barring the occasional moment in the third act, which admittedly does feel a bit rushed and messy. But for the most part, these people feel like they're in a movie, and it showcases some of JR's directorial skills within the SOV subgenre at their sharpest so far. The cine, much like the direction, is just about passable. But there isn't really a lot in the way of experimentation, which is a bit of a downer. Scenes are constructed to put across the plot in the most convenient and quickest way possible, and while an eye is kept on composition, the line for the most part, and framing, there was never really any whoa moments in this one. It all just feels quite generic, and only exacerbating the problem further, the editing really slips in this one, with shots quite frequently just overrunning enough that it's noticeable, which really surprised me, because the edits for most of these films beforehand have been sweet as a nut. I don't know, maybe it was Christmas, maybe it was apathy. There were just quite a few moments, particularly in the first act, where shots ran over by like a second or two longer than they should. Probably the most notorious piece of editing for this is in the third act, where Jerry goes to blow up one of the scouts' cars with a grenade launcher. In the script, it apparently made it clear that you see the car blow up. JR apparently even bought some stock footage of a car blowing up to cut into the shot to act as the big showstopper. But when the final edit was produced, well, this is what we got. And I think that pretty much tells you everything you need to know about the level of film you're working with here. Performance-wise? Well, it's a bit of a mixed bag. This is probably the best full cast I've seen so far in any of these SOV movies in terms of them being consistently alright with minimal dead weight. And in particular, I have to say that James Black plays an absolute blinder as the deviously malicious Mr. Huntsucker. Much like in Zombie Cop, he really throws his full weight and range behind this role, and the result is a character who comes across as genuinely malicious and easily one of the most enjoyable aspects of this picture. The same really goes for Ken Jarrow's as Jerry, starting things off with a nice, mild-mannered character before developing him with a colder edge. I think it takes a real decent range for an actor to be able to pull that kind of thing off, and I think he does it quite successfully here, especially given the state of play with the production. Finally, the soundtrack. And the one thing I'll say about all of these Bookwalter productions, the soundtracks may have their issues, but they're always of quality. Here though, things get a little bit repetitious. But it's not a bad score. It works for what the film is trying to put across, and honestly, while it may be in the lower half of all the scores I've heard so far, it's high up in that lower half. It's basically got a pounding, synthy edge to it that makes it feel like an early 90s thriller action movie. It's not overbearing, it kinda just rides along gently punctuating key scenes in the background. It's alright. Nothing astounding, just good quality scoring trying to do its thing. Maximum Impact was released on VHS in 1992 by Cinema Home Video. And, as far as I can tell, there it would stay until 2007, when it would be dug out as part of a double feature set with Zombie Cop for the riff series The Bad Movie Cops. It would finally receive a full Blu-ray release in 2020 as part of the SOV 6 pack, and the extras are pretty decent for this kind of a release. There's two making-ofs, a couple of commentaries, some trailers. It's a pretty comprehensive set, and it really lets you get a feel for what the cast and crew were going through while making this. Honestly, I think it'd be a bit overly harsh to call this a bad movie. It's underwhelming, definitely, but I've seen bad SOV in my time. And this? Well, it's competent and maybe a little low on excitement, but it's definitely not unwatchable. It's the kind of movie that's total middle ground grey zone fodder. It exists. I'm sure there are people who like it and people who loathe it. For me, I'd use it as a filler for an SOV movie night. I think it'd help act as a decent, inoffensive palate cleanser to help set the tone for something a bit more striking. I don't think I could recommend going out of your way to watch this one. There are films in this set that do a better job of this kind of genre than this movie does, but if you stumble on it in the wild and have an hour to kill, this one exists. Go get her. I think...